This video is brought to you by Surfshark. Nuclear is reliable, works 24/7, and generates a lot of power, all for essentially zero carbon. But that comes at a price. Nuclear plants are really expensive, legislatively challenging, difficult to scale, and have a hotly debated reputation. But what if there was a way to build smaller, cheaper, and safer nuclear facilities sized for individual businesses or small communities? It might sound like an atomic age dream, but it's already here. Is shrinking and modularizing nuclear facilities the path towards a nuclear future? And is nuclear really as bad as many of us think it is? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. Just go nuclear is a common refrain in the comment sections of my videos when I discuss clean energy production. Nuclear power has a lot to offer, both as part of our energy mix as we wait for renewables to fill in the gaps that are left by the fossil fuel industry, and as a partner with renewables just in general. One major problem that continues to drag this 70-year-old technology down, though, is the size and complexity of nuclear power plants. And that's not even getting into the big three hurdles associated with nuclear: its hazards, the waste it produces, and its cost. The US-based company Last Energy is attempting to address these issues, but not by reinventing the wheel, so to speak. They're taking well-tested technology, shrinking it down to modular nuclear power plants known as small modular reactors, or SMRs. And these occupy only half an acre of land, but they're capable of producing 20 megawatts of electricity. They fit neatly within the dimensions of the coal power plants they can replace, all while being much, much more compact than traditional nuclear power plants. They're also strong enough to power individual energy-intensive sites like factories and data centers. But if they're not reinventing the wheel and bringing some new technology to the mix, how does making nuclear power plants smaller make them better? Well, to understand that, we have to go back to those big three obstacles to adopting nuclear power. We can't really disentangle small modular reactors without it. Now, isn't nuclear dangerous? Let's start by addressing the dangers associated with nuclear energy. Wouldn't building a bunch of SMRs increase the chance of catastrophe? Well, believe it or not, nuclear power is actually one of the least deadly forms of energy on the planet. It sits right between solar and wind and way below fossil fuels, which can cause an estimated 3.6 million deaths a year. To put this in perspective, our World in Data looked at the deaths from pollution and accidents related to power generation. Its 2020 report on the safety of energy sources found that the death rate of wind is 0.04 per terawatt hour of electricity. For solar, it's 0.02. And nuclear energy? Again, sandwiched right between the two with a death rate of 0.03 per terawatt hour. Meanwhile, coal topped the charts at 32.72 deaths per terawatt hour. Now, keep in mind that the entire planet used an estimated 22,848 terawatt hours in 2019. That comes out to a lot of human suffering caused by fossil fuels, considering that fossil fuel energy sources require mines and drilling operations, which often account for many injuries and fatalities, especially across a global market. That, of course, does not mean that the suffering caused by nuclear meltdowns is any less significant. While the epidemiology of these cases is still hotly debated, it's generally agreed that 30 to 60 people died as a direct result of Chernobyl, the worst of history's three major nuclear accidents, now the others being Fukushima and Three Mile Island. It was no doubt a tragedy that caused incredible hardship, considering these losses alongside the injuries, evacuations, and cancer experienced in the aftermath. However, looking at the long view, we've had nuclear power plants since the 1950s. There are 413 active nuclear power plants in the world today, but there have only been three serious disasters in total. It's also worth noting that Chernobyl was an RBMK reactor developed by the Soviet Union, which was very different from the pressurized water reactors, or PWRs, that make up the vast majority of reactors around the world today. The specifics of these reactors could be their own video, but suffice to say RBMKs had a number of design flaws that made them a lot less safe than PWRs. In a nutshell, a PWR is just much better design with decades of safe operation. So how does Last Energy's small modular reactor deal with the potential dangers of nuclear energy? Well, the reactors are also PWRs with the now common additional safety feature of an underground site. If a meltdown does happen, the risk of harmful particles escaping to the air is greatly reduced. Plus, smaller reactors don't run as hot, so they're less likely to melt down, and a small reactor will also have fewer moving parts, which means fewer failure points. Now, while the risk of airborne radioactive particle releases is lower, the underground site must be carefully chosen to avoid potential contamination of groundwater, both during normal operation and during flooding, where rainwater could be contaminated before running off into the watershed. So when you take into account the number of disasters relative to the number of power plants, technological advances, and new safety procedures, the dangers of nuclear energy, even in an event of a meltdown, are far less of an issue than before. But what about nuclear waste, and how is Last Energy planning to handle that? Now, before we get to that, there's something else that I don't think is a waste, and that's today's sponsor, Surfshark. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial tracking and machine learning to apply very targeted advertising. A VPN can protect you from some of that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. I actually did that recently in the UK. Now this can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. And one of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. The link's in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to the question about nuclear waste and how Last Energy is going to handle it. Now the vast majority of reactors here in the US are a once-through nuclear fuel cycle. And to keep the explanation simple, the uranium ore is mined, enriched into the right kind of uranium, turned into fuel pellets, and used in a reactor. Then those spent pellets become radioactive waste that needs to be stored somewhere. And yes, I was as disappointed as you are to learn that radioactive waste is just little gray pellets and not glowing green Ninja Turtle ooze. It's important to note that only 3% of that waste is the scary stuff that will be harmful for thousands of years to come. We don't make very much of it either, just around half an Olympic swimming pool per year. Which sounds like a lot, but really isn't when you consider just how much carbon-free energy that we're getting out of the deal, and you can also rest a little easier knowing that there's zero recorded deaths attributed to nuclear waste leakage. So how do we safely store it? Well, the most common method, at least here in the US, is called dry casking. Now first, all those rod assemblies take that refreshing dip in the bottom of that spent fuel pool. Now water is of course great at cooling things off, but it's also very good at dampening radiation. Once everything is nice and inert, usually in just a few years' time, the rods are then placed in a stainless steel canister, which are welded shut, and then you have your dry cask. The casks are only rated to last about 40 years, but the waste can be rehomed into a new cask or moved to a more permanent storage facility. And the most promising of which is a deep geological disposal, or DGD facility. Now these do exactly what they say on the tin. We place the casks deep underground in geologically stable regions and entomb them under tons of concrete and earth. Now there's just one not so little thing. There aren't any long-term storage facilities currently in operation, which means most nuclear facilities have to keep those casks on site, at least for now. Now good news though, Finland is set to open the first DGD facility later this year, so help is coming. Still, this is not the kind of problem that you can ignore, especially if nuclear power reaches the popularity we want it to. With hundreds of facilities storing little tons of this harmful stuff for no joke, up to 24,000 years, there's a lot of possible points of failure. Solutions like dry casking and deep geological storage might be good enough for now, but are they 24,000 year proof solutions? It's kind of difficult to say. I'm gonna guess no. So what's Last Energy doing to mitigate the issue of nuclear waste? Well, their power plants can last about 40 years, but about every 6 years, they'll swap out the reactor for a new one. It's a lot like replacing a battery, just nuclear sized. Now, here's the neat part. The old reactor continues to house the spent fuel inside. After all, it was safe enough when it was smashing atoms to create electricity. It'll be even safer now that the fuel is spent. Then Last Energy can just haul the whole reactor slash waste cask off with minimal danger or chance of spillage. But we could also look at recycling that waste into more energy. How? A closed fuel cycle. Because more than 90% of the potential energy remains in spent nuclear fuel, even after 5 years of operation in a reactor, spent waste could actually be reused as a nuclear fuel. Better yet, every time that waste goes through a fuel cycle, the half-life of the radioactive elements are reduced down to hundreds of years, which is obviously a much more manageable time frame than 24,000 years. Now, the United States currently does not recycle its nuclear waste, though other countries do. Japan has been leading the R&D charge in recycling this waste. The Japanese Federation of Electric Power Companies argues that on top of making the waste safer, its closed fuel cycle adds another layer of energy security, reduces dependence on foreign imports of uranium, and allows for getting the most energy out of the uranium that they've already purchased. So what's not to like? Well, Last Energy isn't promising this, but it's theoretically an option. Now that we've established that nuclear energy is much safer than you might have thought, here comes the next big question. The same problem goes for the high costs, right? As much as the Just Go Nuclear crowd likes to point out its huge benefits, the cost of nuclear power is one of the biggest limiting factors. It's just more expensive. Nuclear power plants are indeed really expensive in terms of both capital costs and operating costs. Capital refers to components of the initial price tag, stuff like site preparation, engineering manufacturing, construction, commissioning, permitting, financing, you get the idea. Altogether, initial costs for your average 110 megawatt plant are about $6 to $10 billion. Ouch. These costs are a lot higher than other forms of energy production because nuclear plants are both very complex and naturally held to an extremely high safety standard. Now, almost every part of the process from beginning to end requires extensive work at the hands of multiple highly qualified experts. And it's a long process too, with an average construction time for even the most modern plants taking about 9.2 years to complete. That can leave a lot of room for potential design changes, tech upgrades, and a variety of lawsuits to crop up, all of which compound the existing time and money issues. Meanwhile, operations tend to be costly too. Nuclear fuel isn't cheap, and neither is the professional labor it takes to run the plant. But extra expenses also come from standardization, or more accurately, the lack of it. Unlike oil, gas, or other industries, nuclear energy never established a standardized set of tools. This adds to the cost because you can't just pop down to the nuclear energy store and grab a universal plutonium rod or pipe fitting. Most nuclear power plants are bespoke. In contrast, France runs dozens of very similar standardized nuclear power plants. Besides reducing overall costs, it provides a mechanism for additional safety. If something begins to fail at one power plant, all the others can be quickly checked and repaired. And based on this model, a company that can provide a standardized nuclear power plant can be much safer and less expensive as they share those standardized parts. And if you thought nuclear was expensive on first blush, just wait, there's more. The measure known as levelized cost of energy, or LCOE, represents the lifetime cost divided by the energy production, which makes it easier to fairly compare technologies. LCOE accounts for not just the large installation fees the projects face, but also how much bang you're getting for your buck stretched out over the entire span of the project. Now, according to the 2022 annual World Nuclear Industry Status Report, solar has an LCOE of $36 per megawatt hour, wind clocks in at $38 per megawatt hour, and coal costs $108 per megawatt hour. Not good for coal, and one of the many reasons it's dying off. But nuclear power costs around $167 per megawatt hour, making this the most expensive form of energy production amongst the methods that were surveyed, and the only one to actually go up in price during the study period of 2009 to 2021. Yikes. Now, just based on economies of scale and how difficult it is to get a plant approved, you'd think that bigger plants would be more cost-effective. But here more than anywhere else, Last Energy's strategy of minerization and standardization pays off. With their modular factory line plug-and-play approach, Last Energy can deploy their SMRs blindingly fast, in less than 2 years. And because they're small and modular, these reactors actually scale quite well. You can always upgrade simply by adding another module. Here's their CEO, Brett Kugelmass, who I interviewed for my Still to Be Determined podcast.
Since we're delivering literally the exact same thing every single time, we don't have to run through, you know, a $20 or $30 million exercise for each individual plant. We can hit the, you know, the copy and paste button based on the application we submitted last time.
They're fast and easy to construct, but how much will they actually cost you? Well, around $123 million. It's also way cheaper than a standard-sized, beefy boy nuclear plant with, again, a minimum $6 billion price tag and almost decade-long construction time. If something does need to be repaired, this is where the benefits of standardization come in again. No more time-consuming, custom designing, followed by review boards, followed by machining, or more testing. You get the idea. I think Brett put it best when he said this.
We are innovative in how uninnovative we are. we're just not tackling like a physics challenge. Instead, we're tackling like a supply chain procurement and economic challenge.
Now, this is the part of the video where I'd normally say something along the lines of, gee, this tech is cool. Let's hope it hits the market soon. But these plants are already here. Poland, the UK, and others have already purchased reactors from Last Energy, and more on the way.
This is a big week. You're catching me at the end of like the greatest week of my life. This week, we sold over 30 power plants.
So go ahead and fill in your undecided bingo card free space, because here, as always, there's no one solution to rule them all. No silver bullet. There's no just go nuclear or just go solar to the debate. It's going to take a mix of solutions. The danger nuclear energy poses to people and the environment pales in comparison to the harm caused by fossil fuels. At the same time, nuclear waste is a real concern that doesn't have a clear, permanent solution, at least at the moment. And as good as the death rates look for nuclear compared to other forms of energy production, that doesn't tell the whole story about the impacts on a population affected by a nuclear disaster. Ultimately, nuclear may not be the solution, but it's a solution. If we can get nuclear's high price tag under control, reduce its footprint, and speed up its deployment as Last Energy is trying to do, then it could be an essential part of the green energy mix going forward. We just don't have the time or luxury to let the perfect be the enemy of the good. And nuclear energy, especially in this small modular reactor form, looks really good. So what do you think? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still TBD, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.